Okay, so let me talk about CIPMN financial information. And this presentation is mainly based on the references that already given to you in on the syllabus. Okay, so financial statement information bisa dipakai untuk memprediksi kinerja perusahaan di capital market. So kita mulai dari perspektif ini. We gonna use this perspective to talk about CIPM and APT. That is financial statement information can be used to predict company's performance in the capital market. And in other words, financial statement information can affect the share performance of public company. Jadi informasi pasar, informasi keuangan yang ada di dalam financial statement itu bisa menentukan, mempengaruhi kinerja saham perusahaan publik. What do I mean with the performance? Include the share price, share return, trading volume, and also price volatility, and others performance indicator. Share price, first one. Share price, I think it's quite straightforward, ya. Yeah. Share price, harga saham yang dibentuk dari demand dan supply from investors. Share return, return is actually price changes, perubahan harga. The difference between price of T plus one, time plus one, and price time T. Jadi selisih antara harga pada waktu T plus satu dan harga pada waktu T. To return, selisih harga, price differences. Trading volume is actually straightforward. Trading volume berarti volume share yang diperdagangkan. Price volatility is also straightforward. Price volatility adalah price fluctuation, ya. Yeah. The up and down of the price, share price. So, back to my point, back to the perspective that we can use, all the financial information released by the firm will affect all these share performance indicators, including price, return, trading volume, and also volatility. So how to show it? How to explain the association between financial statement information and share performance? The best way to prove, the best way to show the association between financial information and stock performance is by studying CIPM and APT. Jadi kita belajar CIPM dan APT itu tujuannya untuk melihat hubungan antara financial information dengan share performance. Okay. We are not going to use the CIPM and APT to make investment decision. the book that I give as a reference, that is Woody and Kane and Marcus, it is about investment. So the discussion of CIPM and FPT in this book, in Woody et al. 2014, is mostly related to investment decision. However, I think it is not too relevant with our learning goals or learning outcomes. So I will take another angle from the same reference. So we still use this book. However, we have to see topic, we have to discuss the topic from different angles, from the perspective that is financial information can be used to predict share performance. Okay. So we have to know some basic terms. Kita harus ngerti beberapa basic terms that are used in this discussion. Tapi ada banyak sekali term yang didiskusikan, namun tidak cukup baik dijelaskan, ya. So we have to explain it more clearly. Yeah. First, PI. You will see many symbols of PI. PI adalah price of share I, yaitu harga saham perusahaan E, share price of firm I. And then return I, or sometimes we simply use RET, RET I. Return I is share return of firm I. Okay, and we calculate return of firm I by using that formula, which is quite simple. Price of share I in time T minus price of share I in time T minus 1 divided by PI T minus 1. Okay. Harga saham perusahaan I pada periode T dikurangi harga saham perusahaan I pada periode T minus 1 dibagi harga saham perusahaan I pada periode T minus 1. Itu kita sebut dengan return. And then we have to know market return. Kalau ini adalah return dari semua saham yang diperdagangkan di bursa efek. So it is not only the return of single stock. Instead, it is the return of all shares traded in the capital market. Okay. Misalnya, in Indonesia, we know this IHSG, Index Harga Saham Gabungan, or sometimes we call as GCI, Jakarta Stock Exchange Composite Index. Okay. It is actually the average return of all shares traded in the capital market, okay, at a certain point of time, pada waktu tertentu, itu yang dikenal dengan market return. And then you gonna see many words of securities. what do we mean with securities is actually stock or bonds or options traded in the exchange. Jadi semua tuh saham, obligasi maupun option yang diperdagangkan di stock exchange. Apa itu options? So if you do not know what is option, please find by yourself, search Google what does option mean. So CIPM is actually a model that predicts the expected return of a stock or a portfolio. Okay. Jadi CIPM sebenarnya adalah model yang memprediksi expected return sebuah saham atau portofolio. Oke. Maaf ya sebentar. Expected return ini sometimes disebut sebagai cost of equity. Oke. Okay. Jadi kalau ada kata cost of equity, you have to know that cost of equity has the same meaning with expected return, which is a return that is expected by the average investors. Okay. Return saham yang return saham I yang diharapkan secara rata-rata oleh investor. Okay. This model predict the expected return of an equity asset atau stock investment as a function of the risk-free asset return plus the return from market portfolio instruments adjusted for the company's typical risk factors. Jadi, model ini membuat prediksi CIPM membuat prediksi, mempredik, mengestimasi bahwa expected return saham I merupakan fungsi dari penjumlahan dari risk-free asset return, ya, return dari risk-free asset plus return dari market. Return dari market yang disesuaikan dengan risiko perusahaan. Oke. Untuk membuat lebih jelas, kita lihat model. So, expected return share I can be formulated or can be expected, can be computed, or expected return of share I is a function of risk-free asset return, return dari aset bebas risiko, which is RF, plus the second term is risk premium. Ini disebut dengan risk premium, premi risiko. Oke. Okay. Yaitu selisih antara return pasar dengan return aset bebas risiko. expected RI is expected return of an equity asset share I. Saya pikir itu jelas ya. Expected return yang disimbolkan dengan ERI adalah expected return of equity asset, which is share I. And then RF is risk-free asset return, yaitu, for example, return dari government bond. Atau kalau you lihat di buku, in the book they use T-bills bond, ya. Atau treasury bonds. Okay, actually they are the same, yaitu government bond return. Why do we call this government bond return as risk-free asset? Because government bond has very 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 small risk to be default. Jadi obligasi pemerintah itu memiliki risiko yang sangat 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 kecil untuk gagal bayar. In the history of modern economy, mungkin belum banyak atau sangat sedikit fakta pemerintah gagal bayar obligasi. I think the last examples is Greece, ya. Greece case, kasus di Yunani mungkin beberapa waktu lalu pemerintahnya gagal bayar obligasi, tapi then recovered very quickly, ya, bisa di recover secepatnya. So we use government bond returns as benchmark. Nah, then RM is actually portfolio return atau combination of all stock on the exchange, yaitu return pasar, return market. For example, IHSG atau Stock Exchange Composite Index. And then beta I adalah specific risk of share I, that is the covariance between RI and RM. Okay. Kita lihat dulu persamaan ini, bahwa expected return untuk saham I itu minimal sama dengan risk free asset return. Oke. Kita benchmarknya itu dulu. You tidak mungkin sebagai rational investor. If you were rational investor, you will not buy the stock that provide you the exact return that the same as government bond return. You tidak mungkin membeli saham yang menyediakan return sama dengan return obligasi pemerintah. Kenapa enggak mungkin, Pak? Lah, apa gunanya? Mending saya membeli, lebih baik saya membeli obligasi pemerintah karena bebas risiko. Tapi kalau saya membeli saham, as you know, there is no guarantee for stock return, kan? Tidak ada jaminan bahwa stok itu akan memberikan certain return for you. Tidak ada garansi. There is no guarantee that the stock will give you certain amount of return. So there will be a risk. Pasti ada risiko that your investment will give enough return as you expect, atau bahkan mungkin you will lose your investment. Kalau utang, if you give a loan, at least there is a guarantee from the law and also from the at least from the legal that you will have the payback, you will have the the loan payback to you, kan? You akan dapatkan pinjamanmu balik karena itu dilindungi secara legal. However, tidak ada jaminan semacam itu di investasi saham. Kalau you invest di saham, you invest in stock, there are three possibilities. First, the company will be survive and give you return for whatever amount. So at least you can wait until your investment payback. Ya kan? You tunggu saja sampai return-nya itu menutup semua modal yang you investasikan. Or the firm will not be survive, then you will lose your investment and no guarantee to pay back the investment. Atau yang ketiga, akan survive juga, the firm will be survive, however it gives you very small amount of return and you need to wait a long time to get the payback. Kan bisa juga begitu. Nah, so if you buy a stock, the first benchmark is always the risk-free asset return. Berapa return dari obligasi pemerintah? Then, because equity atau share is risky asset, ya, share itu adalah risky asset, aset beresiko, then you will expect additional return, kan gitu ya? Kalau you rasional ya, karena investasi saham itu beresiko, ya tiga tadi kan, survive dan give you enough return, survive but give you very small return, or not survive, kan? So it is risky investment. Because it is risky investment, then you will expect additional return. Kita sebut sebagai risk premium karena you sudah ambil risiko tambahan, seharusnya you dikompensasi dengan return tambahan, kan gitu. Because you invest in risky asset, then it is reasonable to expect additional return greater than risk free asset return. Oleh sebab itu ditambahkan di second term, in the second term, this one, the blue box one, itu adalah additional return yang you expect because you invest in risky asset. Okay, and the additional return that you expect itu minimum ya sama dengan return market dong. ya kan rasionalnya gitu saja. Kalau saya beli saham PTX, so I buy the share of company X. How much return that I expect adalah first, the return must be risk-free asset plus something, ya kan? Risk-free asset, return plus return tambahan. Berapa banyak return tambahannya? Harusnya return tambahannya sama dengan return rata-rata pasar. Nah, tadi sudah disinggung, kalau semua investors akhirnya mendapatkan risk-free return plus market return, sehingga semua investor mendapat return yang sama. If all investor get the same return, then there will be no trading anymore. Buat apa saya trading kalau semua investors mendapatkan return yang sama? Ngerti ya? So harus ada pembeda satu share dengan share yang lain, itu harus berbeda profil risikonya, nggak boleh sama. Oke, bagaimana membuat berbeda? So saya ini dulu, saya apa namanya, misal nih ya, maaf, misal begini nih fungsinya. So expected return share I adalah risk free asset return plus return pasar. Kalau begini, maka semua investor will get the same amount of return and there will be no trading anymore. Karena it's not interesting for investor, nggak menarik lagi. Ngapain kalau itu semua sama? Karena return market kan sama. Kamu trading di Jakarta Stock Exchange, ya you dapatnya segitu, ya sudah. Akhirnya kan sama semua. Nah, lalu, okay. Lalu faktor pembedanya di mana? Faktor pembedanya. Maaf, the second term ini kalau misalkan tadi saya bilang, maaf sebentar aja ya. Oke, let make an example. Misal, risk-free asset adalah 10%. Oke. Harusnya, if you buy stock I or share I, you minta return 10% plus, ya kan? 10% plus tambahan return dong. Nah, tambahan return yang you harapkan adalah return pasar di atas return risk-free asset. Jadi kalau risk-free asset-nya 10% and then the market return adalah berapa ya? Misalkan 14% gitu. Misal begini. Maka akhirnya expected return I itu sama dengan return market, yaitu 14%, kan ini cancel akhirnya, kan mereka positif dan negatif, selesai. Nah, kalau saya trade, saya dagang, saya invest, dapatnya sepasar ini profitnya sama. Yeah, it's not interesting. You dagang, datang ke pasar, profit semua pedagang sama. Lah, ngapain saya dagang? Nah, market akhirnya gagal. Ya kan, market tidak berfungsi. Ngerti ya sampai di sini ya. Nah, oleh sebab itu kita perlu memperhitungkan, we have to consider the specific risk of share I, yaitu beta ini. So beta represent specific risk of share I. Nah, apa ini Pak beta ini? So beta itu adalah covariance antara RI dan RM. RI, you know, return of stock E, stock I, sorry. RM is return of composite index, market index. Ya kan? Covariance itu korelasi, in other words, correlation. Jadi, kalau return market-nya, for instance, RM, for example, ya, misalkan RM-nya increase, RI ternyata, surprisingly, RI juga increase. Oke. Next time RM decrease. So RI juga decrease. Oh, berarti gerakan si return market dengan si return company I itu sama. Positively correlated. Ya. Nah, karena korelasinya positif, jadi kita bisa berharap if the market risk, the market return increase, then the expected return of share I will increase as well. Karena mereka punya the same movement. Okay. So let's see an example. So to make it more clear, what does beta means? Beta means specific risk of share I, formulated as the covariance between market return and share I return. Okay. RM is market return, for example IHSG, composite index. The average return of all stocks traded in the capital market. RM with head adalah the average market return, average berarti rata-rata for certain periods. RI, return of share I, and then RI with head is the average of share I. Jadi dihitung dengan formula ini, we use this formula to determine the beta itself, the specific risk of share I, which is the co-movement between RI and RM. The movement can be positive, which means if RM increase, the RI will increase as well. The beta can be negative, which means if the RM decrease, RI will increase on the other hand. However, beta will not be zero. Ya, tidak mungkin beta itu zero. Tidak mungkin. So beta is a standard measure of stock price response to the movement of market returns. Jadi kalau rata-rata pedagang, rata-rata investors in the capital market expect high return, then IHSG or composite index will increase. And then what will happen with the stock I return? Will it increase or decrease? If stock I increase following the rise of composite index, then the beta is positive. However, if the stock I return decrease following the increase of market index, then the beta is negative. So for example, if the IHSG or the composite index rises 2% and stock I also rises 2%, stock I return also rises 2%, then beta is 1. And it is very unlikely to happen. Sangat tidak mungkin ada saham yang betanya itu 1, persis sama dengan IHSG. Ya, itu rasional juga. Misalkan ada 10 orang, rata-rata nilainya adalah 70. Apakah si A, anggota pertama, itu memiliki nilai 70 juga? Itu kan very unlikely. Kalau rata-rata 70, berarti 70 semua. Enggak mungkin. Ya. Ini soal probability. Soal probability sangat unlikely bahwa satu orang juga punya nilai 70. Apalagi kalau misalkan all members average, ya, average nilainya naik 10. Apakah si A, the first member, juga mengalami kenaikan 10? I think it is very unlikely. Sangat sulit. It is not, saya tidak mau bilang impossible, ya, sangat unlikely lah. It is unlikely to happen that the beta is 1. It's still possible, but it is very unlikely, ya, sangat rendah. So in the CIPM, beta is a risk factor that explains the relationship between return of stock I and market returns. Disitulah poin penting dari CIPM. So in the CIPM, let's see this example, ya. The composite index return in year T is 1%. Government bonds return is 0.2%. Why it is very small? Ya, karena risk-free asset. No risk, no return. High risk, high return. Kan gitu. Kalau risiko rendah, ya jangan berharap return yang tinggi dong. Doesn't make sense. Okay. And risk factor of stock I, for example, the beta is 0.5. The question, what is the expected return of stock I? Then we can do simple math. Plug in all the numbers into the formula, and kita bisa dapat, so the expected return of stock I is 0.6%. 0.6% below the risk, the return market, below the market return. Kenapa kok lebih rendah dari market return, Pak? Ya, karena risk factor-nya, karena faktor risikonya. Okay, so the special thing in CAPM adalah the risk factor itself that determines how far the expected return of stock I from the general market expectation. Seberapa jauh antara ekspektasi stock I dengan general expectation of market. Okay. So, bagaimana interpretasinya? Risk-free asset memberikan return 0.2%. Why is it small? Karena it is risk-free asset. Yeah, no risk, no return. Low risk, low return. High risk, high return. It's common sense. And what is the expected return of stock I which has a risk of 0.5? The answer is 0.6%. Stock I offers a higher return than risk-free asset because it has higher risk. Stock I menawarkan return yang lebih tinggi karena stock I introduce risiko yang juga lebih tinggi. As I said, there is no legal guarantee to pay back stock investment. Kan enggak ada garansi legal investasi saham harus kembali, gitu kan enggak ada. The legal protection is only for loan investment. Okay. Thus, the only attribute of stock I that distinguishes the expected return of stock I from other stock is beta. Jadi beta inilah yang secara khas menentukan specific expected return dari stock I. Okay. Then the question, what does determine beta? Apa yang mempengaruhi beta? Ini yang menjadi focus of our discussion. Okay. CAPM is actually a single factor model. The term RM minus RF is risk premium. Yeah, we call this as risk premium. The excess of market return over risk-free asset return. Kan kelebihan return dari return pasar di atas return risk-free asset. The risk premium is the only factor that determines the expected return of an asset. Jadi risk premium itu RM minus RF. It is the only factor that determines the expected return of an asset. Because you will not, as a rational investors, you will not expect that the stock will give you a return that is exactly the same as risk-free asset. Buat apa you invest ke saham yang ngasih return cuman persis sama dengan
return obligasi pemerintah. Ya kan sia-sia. Risiko lebih tinggi kok dapatnya sama dengan risk free asset. It doesn't make sense lah. Jadi, the only factor yang you pertimbangkan adalah risk premiumnya, kan? Oke. So, I can modify the CAPM model using this form. Expected return of stock I is the function of risk-free asset plus some risk premium, some factor. Kan? And the CAPM predict positive expected return for factors that move positively with the market portfolio. Kalau betanya positif, expected return-nya juga RF plus something, ya kan? Kalau betanya negatif, berarti expected return will be RF minus something, and you will be less likely to invest in an asset that has negative beta. Kan. Jadi it is a single factor model. CAPM is a single factor model. However, using that very simple model, CAPM wants to be an absolute valuation model that can value any asset. Stock, bonds, options, and others. Karena memang simple, it is, ya kan simple modelnya, it is risk-free asset plus some factor. Kan cuma begitu saja. Plus a single factor, sudah selesai. What is the factor you can mention, you can name it? Oh, the factor should be risk premium, which is risk market minus risk free, okay lah, or other factor. And the CAPM, which is trying to become an absolute valuation model, is like determining the price of product based on the cost of the product plus a certain amount of profit. Kan logikanya sama dengan costing ya, pricing lah. Berapa, how much, apa namanya, maaf, what is the price of your product is actually cost of product plus profit. Kan cuma gitu saja. The same logic applies in CAPM. What will be the expected return? The expected return is risk-free asset plus some profit. Kan cuma begitu saja. However, if we see from this perspective, is there any other pricing approach? Ada enggak pendekatan pricing yang lain? Tentu, we can use apa namanya relative valuation approach by comparing our product with the similar product in the market. Kan juga bisa begitu. Instead of computing the cost of product plus profit, why don't you simply follow the price of market? Okay, then this discussion brings you to the second topic, which is arbitrage pricing theory. The verb, the word arbitrage in stock trading means buying stock at low price from one market and selling it in another market at high price. Jadi you beli stock from market A with low price, and then you sell it to market B, the second market, the different market with higher price. Okay, jadi ada dua pasar nih ya. There are two market at least. And the price is different. Kenapa ada beda harga? Okay. So, dengan beda harga, ini seperti memberi kamu risk-free profit, ya kan? You tinggal beli dari market satu, you jual di market kedua, selesai, no risk. Supposedly, the same asset is sold for the same price everywhere, seharusnya begitu. Kalau itu produknya sama, if the product is the same, if the asset is the same, if the stock or the share is the same, it is the share of company I. Dimanapun you jual, seharusnya harganya sama. According to price theory. However, so under equilibrium, arbitrage should not exist. Seharusnya nggak mungkin terjadi aktivitas arbitrage. You buy from low price market and you sell in high price market. Itu harusnya nggak mungkin. Tapi itu terjadi in real life. In Indonesia, I think it is impossible karena kita punya hanya satu market. Ya kan, kita hanya punya Indonesian Stock Exchange, the only stock exchange in Indonesia. However, in US, you have several stock exchange. Ada New York Stock Exchange, ada tiga atau lima stock exchange in US. Jadi itu stock yang sama, share yang sama, saham yang sama can be traded with different price in different market. Okay. So the arbitrage process, ya, yeah, proses you beli dari low price market and then you sell to high price market. This arbitrage process will push the prices of the two markets to be the same. Pada akhirnya itu harga akan balance. Karena there is increased demand in the market at low price. Ya kan? Demand-nya naik. Aku mau beli saham ini karena aku mau jual di pasar sebelah. The demand increases and the price increase as well. Naik tuh harga. And then you sell this stock in high price market. And then the supply increase at that market. If supply increases, price will decreases. Ya kan? Harga akan turun. Akhirnya dua pasar ini akan equilibrium juga. Oke? Okay? Itu aktivitas arbitrase begitu ya. However, the existence of arbitrage gives the idea that the return of a stock is not only determined by the market returns, but also the macroeconomic factors. Kenapa kok ada arbitrage? So in fact, there are arbitrage activities. Tetap ada. Jadi kondisi equilibrium itu nyaris tidak ada. In fact ya, secara fakta, kalau ada beberapa pasar, one price theory itu mungkin tidak terjadi. Loh, so what will determine the price, the market price in every markets, apa yang menentukan harga di setiap pasar? Ini sama-sama, suppose you are trading rice ya, you jual atau you trading rice, beras ya. Beras yang sama, the same rice, you sell in market one and in market two, the price can be different and very likely different. Apa yang membuat berbeda coba? Silakan, apa kira-kira yang membuat berbeda harganya? Halo, Anda jualan beras di pasar satu dan di pasar kedua, harganya bisa beda untuk beras yang sama. Ayo.
Jumlah pembelinya, Pak.
Jumlah pembeli. Ya, jumlah pembeli mempengaruhi demand, oke.
Harga oleh kompetitor,
bisa
Pak.
Beda. Apalagi?
Harga barang yang sama oleh kompetitor lain, Pak.
Harga?
Harga beras oleh kompetitor yang lain, Pak.
Oke, different competitor in the different market. Oke, bagus. Apalagi?
Mungkin tren ekonomi, Pak.
Ya?
Tren ekonomi.
Tren ekonomi maksudnya?
Jadi maksudnya dalam yang mempengaruhi harganya berbeda itu adalah tren ekonomi.
Ya, ya, contoh spesifiknya apa?
Seperti mungkin di toko ini beras ini paling booming gitu, Pak.
Mungkin adalah di kedua pasar, kalau ini beda negara atau beda wilayah, mungkin punya inflasi yang berbeda. Ya, inflasi yang berbeda, the different inflation, the different demand, different competitor, apalagi different distribution cost. Ya kan, you distribute kirim barang ke pasar satu dengan you distribute your goods to market two, they need different cost dan sebagainya. So back to our point here, macroeconomic factors can determine the expected return of stock I. Ya, bukan cuman market return saja. I think the possible arbitrage activity can be done if the company listed in different stock exchange. Misal nih, for example, Indosat and Telkom Indonesia. They listed in Indonesian Stock Exchange and also in Singapore Stock Exchange, for example. Ya kan? So you can purchase stock, the Indosat and Telkom stock from low price market and then you sell it to high price market. Kan? Sekarang dengan less border investment, kita bisa trading stock across country gitu ya, untuk company yang sama. So what determines the market price adalah microeconomic vectors. Okay, so APT, arbitrage pricing theory, tries to model the expected return as a function of several factors, not only one factors as CAPM does. Okay. Bisa dirumuskan kalau CAPM it has only one factor, but in APT it has several factors. Okay. F is a factor that pervasively affects yang secara serius terus-menerus mempengaruhi return stock I. Okay. APT predict that the expected return of a security will be linearly related to the sensitivity of pervasive factors with the intercept of risk-free security return. Interceptnya tetap risk-free asset. Minimum risknya adalah risk-free asset. However, they include many factors that pervasively affect the RI. Okay. Inflation, GDP, competition and others, ya, banyak sekali faktor yang bisa dimasukkan ke sana. Intuitively, these factors can be market returns, interest rate, energy prices, national income, dan sebagainya. Okay. So the questions then: can the characteristic of the company also be a factor? Nah, itu tadi yang sempat dirumuskan oleh Fama and French. Fama and French menggunakan small sama high, ya kan? Small and large company sebagai factor. So, company size sebagai factor. Tadi di the last presentation about Fama and French pricing theory, mereka faktornya adalah company size. Okay. So, what are the determinants of beta? The literature shows several factors that affect beta. Financial leverage. Misal, the higher the debt, the higher the risk of default. So investors face a higher risk of uncertainty. Higher beta. If all variables are constant, investor demand higher expected returns. Akhirnya. Okay, ya kan? Sekali lagi, the higher the debt, the higher the risk of default. Gagal bayarnya tambah tinggi dong. Higher risk of uncertainty. As the result, investor will demand higher expected return. Jadi betanya akan tambah tinggi. Gak mungkin cuman sama dengan return market. Gak mau. Oke. Okay? Operating leverage. The higher the fixed cost, the greater the risk that investor will face, yaitu risiko bahwa income less than the fixed cost. Kalau ini company punya fixed cost tinggi, maka risikonya adalah the risk adalah income will be less than the fixed cost. So again, in that sense, investor will demand higher expected return. As a result, the beta will be higher. Okay. Unexpected earnings that investor do not anticipate indicate higher risk. Yeah. Even it is positive unexpected earnings or the negative unexpected earnings. Berarti kalau ada positive unexpected earnings, the company face higher risk. Apalagi kalau negative unexpected earnings, pasti penaltinya lebih tinggi. Growth, ya, companies that focus on growth tend to invest more. So the uncertainty of investment return is higher. As a result, investor face higher risk and they will demand higher expected stock return. Kita akhirnya juga akan lebih tinggi. And you can find another determinants from the literature. So, how to estimating beta? Ini topik yang berbeda. How to estimate beta? Bagaimana kita menentukan beta itu? The first model, and the very popular model is market model. In this market model, beta is estimated using very simple regression model. Ri as a dependent variables, Rm as the independent variables. Ya. RIT adalah return of stock I in time T. RMT is the market return in time T. And you regress both variables and you got the beta. Dan beta I itu. So the above equation can be estimated using monthly or weekly or even daily data. Kan you kumpulin tuh data return saham harian Indofood dari Senin sampai Jumat selama setahun. So you have around 255 data untuk RIT. IHSG-nya juga you ambil IHSG harian Senin sampai Jumat selama setahun. Then you regress. You do regression, you got the BI, beta I. This is very simple, beta estimation. Ada lagi yang market adjusted model dan lain-lainnya. So please check the investment, check your book ya, investment management book, bagaimana estimating beta. The choice of the observation period, which is monthly or weekly or daily, is an issue in beta estimation. Each option has advantages and disadvantages, of course. Daily estimation is the best. However, you need to handle a large of data. Akhirnya, kan you butuh handle data yang agak banyak. The use of the OLS regression method is also an issue. Okay. However, itu yang sudah terjadi dan we can use the OLS regression. Okay, can we estimate beta using financial statement information? The financial ratio variable. Several variables from financial statement are correlated with beta. Yeah, using univariate atau korelasi sederhana atau multivariate regression analysis. Jadi sudah ditemukan according to studies that several variables correlated with beta. So the financial ratios variable, which is proven to be significantly correlated with beta, is used to predict future beta. Nah, misalnya apa ya? Misalnya size ya, company size dan sebagainya. Oke. Okay. Ada isu-isu contemporary yang we have to aware, we have to be aware with these issues. securities written are not only influenced by market factors or macroeconomic factors or company characteristics or company performance. There are some unusual fact found by several studies. We call as market anomaly. Okay, misalnya, for example, the smaller the company, the greater the return. Itu ada, yang begitu. So size effect, and it also it already addressed by Fama and French. Yeah, Fama and French pricing theory. They use size portfolio. January effect. January return are usually higher than the return of the other 11 months. So ada apa di situ? Kenapa di Januari kok return rata-ratanya memang lebih tinggi? Atau Monday effect. Monday's return usually lower than the other 6 days. Nah, ini some anomaly yang kita perlu aware gitu in expecting atau ketika kita membuat expected return for company A. Okay, so my conclusion: research has developed model for determining expected return, namely CAPM and IPT. Beta or variance is the main focus of asset pricing research. And then financial statement information can be an important database for estimating beta with theoretical guidance, of course. Yeah. And then there are still opportunities to explain the odd behavior of security returns, as I just talked in the last slide. Okay, I will stop at this point. If you have any questions, please silakan.